dashing through the snow. And one horse up and sleigh. All the fields we go, laughing all the way. Bells on bobtail ring, making spirits bright. What fun it is to ride and sing a sleigh song tonight.
Morning, everyone. Anybody ready for some of the word? Everybody say word. So turn your Bibles or scroll on your mobile devices to Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2, we're going to take a look at just a snippet. We'll be there in a while. It's going to take a little bit to get there. Well, I have just enjoyed teaching from God's word to you this Christmas month, and as much as I have any other Christmas season. And the reason is because our loving Heavenly Father has done miracles in your lives. And it's just been amazing. I mean, miracles of healing and just miracles of just seeing people just step into the joy of God's presence this season. And really, unlike for some of you, unlike any other season that you've experienced. And so we've talked about the joy of Christmas. And there's a big difference between joy and happiness. Happiness is always based on outside circumstances, and it's just temporary. It doesn't last. Because as soon as the circumstances go south, the happiness goes south too. But a joy in the Lord is something that is internal, and it lasts forever when you step into the joy of His presence. So we talked about that. We've also talked about the celebration of Christmas, and God loves to party. And He loves to do so in the purest way possible. So I'm excited about this weekend, because this weekend we're talking about the generosity of Christmas. And the generosity of Christmas, you know, the Christmas season is the greatest, it is the greatest story of generosity that's ever been told. It really is. I mean, our loving Heavenly Father's free gift of sending His own Son to heal and to deliver and to give us hope and to give us His joy. And nothing screams a message of generosity like the Spirit, that's capital S, the Holy Spirit, capital S, of Christmas. For God so loved the world that He gave, and He gave, and He gave until it hurt. And it was a spirit of generosity. His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him will never have to perish spiritually, but we have eternal and everlasting life in Him. So Christmas is a wonderful chance to just touch the world with the love of God and with the generosity of God. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to take a look, and we're going to see the remarkable generosity of God in the Christmas story in three perspectives that we're going to take a look at in the true story of the birth of Jesus Christ. And before I get there, though, I want to spend just a few moments. We're going to spend just a little bit of time, because I want to just express a great big Christmas thank you card to you, GV Christian, for your generosity in 2019. I love being a part of a generous church and love being a part of you. Your generosity has just blown me away this year. And God loves it. It's the spirit of Christmas. So we're going to talk about that. I just want to share with you just a brief Christmas card. It'll take just a little bit because, you know, once you go down the path, I mean, you know, you mentioned just a couple of things, and the list just goes on and on and on of your generosity. And then we'll take a look at those three perspectives. But I want to give to you just a couple of recent examples. So just last week, there are a couple of examples that came to the surface, and I want to share those with you. So this past Wednesday, GV Christian Elementary had their last chapel this year. And I mean, you ought to see this place. It's wall-to-wall kids, and they're having fun. They're celebrating Jesus. They're jumping, jumping around. They're just being kids. All control chaos. You don't believe me there, do you? But I'm telling you, it's just, I mean, they're just worshiping and celebrating. And then there's a time where it's a solemn occasion where the Spirit's just moving in their lives. But these kids, now this is first through fifth grade, and these kids made a commitment to raise funds this year for families who would not have Christmas at all, or in fact would not be able to sustain themselves not only during the Christmas month, but other months of the year. And these kids made a commitment together to raise funds. And it wasn't just for toys and games for kids, but it was groceries and meals and clothing and things that were just needed just to sustain a family. And in some cases, just a few miles from our church here, where there are 2 and 3 families living in a small apartment and barely making it by. So you know how much these kids raised? You ready for this? Over $7,900 these kids raised this year. I know. And I... And it was just so cool to see, you know, when the groceries and clothing and things were delivered to them, just the humility, but also the gratefulness and just the joy in doing that. And so it was just so cool. And I know that for some of you parents who have kids in the elementary school, I know you helped out. And so a great big Christmas card, thank you. You know, these kids don't have that money. So anyway, thank you. But I tell you what was so fun, because, you know, we love to laugh and have just a great time here in the purest way possible. And so it was a friendly girl versus boy competition. You know, kids love that. So who would raise the most, the boys or the girls? That would be my guess, but you're wrong. I know. It was the boys. And so I know. So the loser, and I assumed it'd probably be Pastor Steve. Because, you know, boys. But the girls lost. I know. And so Pastor Rebecca and Jamie Bielik, our elementary school principal and director, they got, this was what they had to do. They were doused with slime. I know. Can you imagine how the kids loved that? So here's, I know, there it is. Yeah. And the kids were screaming and yelling, and the boys were jumping up and down, and the girls, you know. But anyway, it was just, it was just so much fun. All right. You know, in October, we made a commitment together at the beginning, and you remember when we made this commitment, if you were here, we made a commitment to partner with Convoy of Hope. And we made a commitment together, and I want a Christmas card thank you to those of you who participated in setting aside one day's wages out of 365 days, one day's wages to give to one day to feed the world. And we partnered with Convoy of Hope. Now, Convoy of Hope is a humanitarian, faith-based ministry, and they are first on the scene when there is any kind of a disaster around the world, a natural disaster, something that happens in an area, not just in our country, but literally around the world. And they are first on the scene with medical supplies, medical personnel, water, food, clothing, and they are there long term, not just the short term. And so you remember, if you were here, that we made that commitment and you gave, thank you, you gave, all of us together, over $42,000. I know. And so you remember, if you were here, so I hand-delivered. I was able to hand because one of the folks from the leadership team from Convoy of Hope was in town, and I was able to hand-deliver, you remember, that check for $42,000. Well, that was distributed all over the world. But I got a call now. This was just a few days ago. I got a call from my daughter who said, "Dad, did you see the report on CBS Evening News?" No, I didn't. But she just happened to catch this report, and I want to share with you the clip. Let's take a look.
As Hurricane Dorian battered Grand Bahama Island last September, Tamar Stewart and his partner Keon Morris scrambled to save their family.
I was like thinking, just praying my head, just save my kids. Everything gone.
Days later, they returned to find little to salvage. But as with so many Bahamians, the damage goes far beyond their possessions.
So they wake up screaming at night.
Yeah.
Not like traumatized, but they do wake up in the night cry.
More than 3 months after the most powerful hurricane ever recorded here, the water is not safe to drink. 300 people are still listed as missing, and some 30,000 Bahamians remain homeless.
That's why Johnny Morris, the founder of Bass Pro Shop at the non-profit Convoy of Hope, are importing a four-day holiday fest.
I just started thinking, now what can we do for the kids? How can we make them happy?
10,000 people attended opening night. Christmas music, Santa Claus, and amusement rides helped them put aside the pain of hurricane recovery. There was even a surprise from above. Skydivers dressed as Elvis. As Tamar and Keon left this temporary wonderland, their arms were filled with toys and groceries, their hearts with joy and gratitude.
When is the last time you've seen them that happy?
What should I say? Before the storm.
We just want these kids to have some fun time and forget about rough times, even for a little while.
Isn't that cool? You had a part in that. You had a part in that. And not just there, but in other parts of the world. And so thank you. And you saw some of those tents. Maybe you didn't. You saw some of the tents in the background. And it wasn't just some of the fun stuff that they highlighted on that brief report, but there were medical personnel that were there taking care of people physically. There were dentists there providing medical care. There were people there even doing haircuts and distributing water and food and clothing. And then there was a tent set up for people to receive post-traumatic care and crisis intervention. So there were people there that were counseling and therapists that were available there. And I love the fact, you know, we had a life changer here. You remember in October, Hal Donaldson, and Hal came and first name basis with the CEO, not only there, the founder of Bass Pro Shops, but also Hobby Lobby and Home Depot and a list of things that go on and on. But listen, it's not just the big donors that make things happen by way of generosity. It's you and it's me as we together. And it makes a huge difference. I cannot thank you enough. We say here so often, you don't just give to GV Christian as much as you give through GV Christian. And so thank you so very much. I love this verse. You know, Jesus said this. It said, the Lord Jesus himself said this, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And so many of you believe that. There will always be those who are cynical. And always be those that can be negative when it comes to generosity, whether it's this season or really any other season. Now, can things be corrupted in this broken world? The answer is, oh, you bet they are. But that still does not negate. Can you imagine the vacuum that would be left if all generosity through Jesus followers were just to be taken away? It really is the pain and the suffering would be much, much, much worse. Because Jesus said this, you and I are called to be salt and light in the scene, wherever the scene might be. And there are those that are going to be dour about this season. But you know what? Those who are dour about this season, they're going to be dour about any other season. That's right. It doesn't matter what season. And in fact, some people use even the excuse, you know, everything is just too commercial, you know, and sometimes... I think it's an excuse to cover up their own greed and selfishness. Would you agree? I mean, you know, that can happen. So a Grinch or a Scrooge spirit can abound. Now, I want to take just a few moments, too, in this Christmas thank you card, just to say a great big thank you to your generosity for you, our volunteers, and our staff. And can't say it enough. To the staff here at GV Christian, thank you. I don't know of anybody that carries any greater demands than the people who serve a congregation during this season of the year and during the rest of the year. And it's not just those of us who are here on full-time staff, but people in so many various departments. And I just can't thank you enough. To those of you on full-time pastoral staff, listen, I believe this. We have the greatest staff in America. I really do believe that. And your pastors love you and serve you and care for you and they sacrifice. Yeah, thank you for expressing your thanks to them. And they, folks, you know, you wouldn't be expected to know all that they do and things that are done behind the scenes. But I've had several chances to thank them, you know, through various gatherings here during the season. So I want to thank you, pastoral staff, for your hard work in ministering to God's people. You know, God said this, I'll give you shepherds after my own heart. And that's, you know, so I thank you for allowing me to give this time in a Christmas thank you card. One pastor and his wife attended 9 Christmas church parties and hosted 4 parties. You know, and for some of you go, if I hosted one, it would put me over the edge. I just can't imagine, you know, and that's along with regular duties and responsibilities. You know, after another evening out, when Meg and I arrived home and we could sit down in the warmth of our home, I leaned over to Meg and I just said, you know, I wish the Christmas season wasn't ending so soon. And it's not because we still had a bunch to do, but it was just because of the joy and the celebration in the presence of our Savior and with God's people, you, during this time of just remembering all that God has given to us. It just brings such joy and such contentment. It has nothing to do with material things. It's that inner joy that God brings. And for those of you who volunteered, a great big Christmas card, thank you to you. Do you know that there are nearly 300 of you who volunteer in one capacity? And that's just about, yeah, thank you. And that's just about 1 out of every 7 people in this congregation do things so that other people can enjoy and experience and be edified by all that's going on in the presence of our Lord. So a great big Christmas card, thank you to you. And just the number of tables that can be set and the meals that can be prepared and the dishes washed, all part of the season of worship and joy and celebration. You know, just before the cross, just before Jesus died on the cross for you and I and rose on the 3rd day, Jesus commissioned 2 of his disciples and he said, would you go and would you make preparations for the Passover meal, which is a central theme and celebration of remembering what God has done. The preparation for the Passover meal, the sacrificial lamb that must be prepared for, the bitter herbs, the table setting, there was so much. And can you imagine those 2 disciples now for all of eternity recorded, they're the ones who set the table for what we call and put a label on the Last Supper. The very nature of setting a table, even if it's paper plates, involves generosity. Thank you, GV Christian, for your generosity. You ready for some of the word? Well, last weekend, you know, we talked about 7 annual feasts that God said to his people, look, celebrate and take time off. Everybody say, yay, God. So take time off and just celebrate and enjoy my presence and enjoy each other and all that God has done in the past, all that God is currently doing today, and tell your kids about this incredible news. So the spirit of Christmas, the Holy Spirit will bring to the surface. It's just amazing. When you face this season or any other season, when it comes to generosity, it'll bring to the surface whatever spirit, small s, is on the inside of a person. So we're going to take a look at 3 very different perspectives when it comes to the Christmas story. Here's the first one. So here's the first one. It comes to generosity in the Christmas story. We're going to read about it, and you've turned to Matthew chapter 2. Here's the first one. We see the first spirit, and a guy by the name of Herod. Herod, we talked about him a little bit this last weekend, and here's his attitude when it comes to generosity. What's mine is mine. What's mine is mine. Now, you remember the Magi, they had come to Herod, and they said, where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? We have seen his star, and we followed it to here. So Herod, he consults with the scribes, and they tell the Magi, Bethlehem. So they go, and by the way, Herod said, look, when you find the one who's been born king of the Jews, come and tell me about it so that I too can come and worship. Now, he was duplicitous in his whole attitude. What's mine is mine. This guy was evil personified. As I mentioned to you, if you're here last weekend, this guy had his wives killed because he considered them to be a threat to his throne and to his kingdom. He strangled to death one of his sons because he considered one of his sons to be a threat to his throne. And in Matthew chapter 2, we pick it up and it says this. It says, when Herod saw that he had been outwitted, so he was ticked off because the Magi, they went and they worshiped, presented their gifts to Jesus, and then they leave. And Herod, I mean, he is ticked off. It says, when Herod saw that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was filled with rage. Sending orders, he put He put to death all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, according to the time he had learned from the Magi. So in the midst of this proclamation of celebrating this great news, this incredible display of a heavenly celebration that God gave to the shepherds and to the Magi, I mean this miracle star as they followed it to where the baby was born, is in the midst of this great joy, is this incredible sadness and grief. All because Herod had this perspective and attitude about his position, his throne, his authority, his money. It's mine. It's mine, and no one is going to take it from me, and no one will touch it. And this has caused untold grief and pain and suffering. Every week, a crime is committed because people say, it's mine and not yours. And the grief and the pain and the suffering. A guy by the name of Josephus, a Jewish historian, recorded this for us. He said that when Herod, just before he knew that he was going to die, he gave orders that when he died, people were to be designated to be murdered because he wanted someone to be crying when he died. He knew how despised he was, and he didn't care. Why? Because it's mine, and I'm going to keep it. No matter what, it's mine, and I'm going to keep it. Now, the best way to capture this perspective on generosity is to just think of a toddler. So most of us are parents in the room. And for those of you that had more than one kid, and I could see it, you know, with our kids, they'd be playing with something, and the other would look at their sibling, and I could see it. I could see it in their eyes. They would zero in, and I could tell what they're thinking. I want that. And sometimes I'd hit up, don't you even think about it. They're playing with that. Don't go near it. Don't go to. But so here's some property laws when it comes to a toddler's perspective. You ready for it? If I like it, it's mine. Right? It might even be happening now in the nursery with your kid. But anyway, right now as we speak. But if I can take it away from you, it's mine. If I had it a while ago, it's mine. If I say it's mine, it's mine. If it looks like mine, it's mine. If you're having fun with it, it's mine. If you lay it down, it's absolutely mine. And if it's broken, it's yours. Yeah. You know, we just don't have to teach our kids to have this attitude when it comes to generosity. They just come by it naturally, don't they? Just like you do and just like I do. Oh, I want that. You have it. You're having fun with that. I want that. And then the scheming starts as to how you can get it. Those little minds, don't you see it when your kids, they just start scheming. How can I get this? And if they release their hand from it for 1 second, they're on it. And all of us still have some simple toddler selfish nature within us. And we don't like to admit that. And none of us are that far from this perspective. It can raise its ugly head at any given moment. Now, as I mentioned, it is amazing what people will hold on to, what they can't keep and fail to gain in Jesus, what you can't lose. Selfish people just cheat themselves and others of so much. Well, here's a second perspective, and it's the perspective of the Magi and the shepherds. And this is their attitude when it comes to generosity. What's mine is yours. Simple, basic foundation of generosity. What's mine is yours. Now, I'm not talking about socialism here. Anybody say, well, that's good news. But no response there. But, it's what's mine is yours. So the true story of the shepherds. So Luke chapter 2, turn to Luke chapter 2, and we'll take a look at verse 15. And let's take a look at the perspective of generosity when it comes to the shepherds. So the angels appear and they say, look, I bring you great news. And it's great joy that will be for all people. What kind of people? All people, everyone. Every country, every language, every background, every educational background, every ethnicity. It doesn't matter. It's for all people. Well, the angels, when they had left them, Luke chapter 2, verse 15, when the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, well, let's go to Bethlehem. And you remember, everybody had an opportunity to go. Herod had an opportunity to go. And an invitation was extended to him because the Magi show up and say, there's been one that's a king of the Jews that's been born. He could have gone. He didn't go. An invitation is extended to every single one of us. So let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. So they hurried off and they found Mary and Joseph, and the baby was lying in a manger. And after they had seen the child, they spread the message they had received about him. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. Skip down to verse 22. And when the time of purification according to the law of Moses was complete, this was the time that a woman, after she gave birth and the bleeding had stopped and the healing was on its way, it was a period of time designated by God. His parents brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. Present him to who? The Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be consecrated to the Lord. This is a precursor. If we had time, it's a whole nother teaching about how the firstborn belongs to God. And it's exactly what Jesus did, what God did rather. He gave his firstborn son as a sacrifice to you and to me. What generosity. And to offer the sacrifice specified in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons, which means Joseph and Mary were at the very bottom rung of the economic ladder. If at all possible, no matter what you had to do, you would present a spotless sacrificial lamb, unless you were below the poverty line, and then a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons could be in the place of the lamb. What's mine is yours. And many of you, many, have grown to this point in your walk with Jesus. Will you understand this principle of generosity? And as soon as you mention generosity, you know what people think automatically, especially in church? They think money. And it's not, is it that? That's a manifestation of generosity because it's who we are. But it's so much more than that. It's our spirit. It's our hearts. It's our love. It's a smile that we give. It's our time. It's a listening ear. Generosity comes in all packages and all sizes. So the shepherd said, let's go. And you know what? We've got to tell somebody about this. We can't just say, this good news is just for us. And they could have had an attitude, you know, we must be living right here. Because shepherds were on the bottom rung of the ladder. We must be doing something right because God showed up and he revealed this to us. We're pretty darn good. No, they said, this isn't something just for us, which, by the way, that is exactly what the nation of Israel did. And that's a whole nother teaching, because God said, you're to be my light beacon to the nations around you. They took what God had given to them and they said, we're a special people. And they failed to be the light beacon of God's grace and his power and his love, which is, and God knew that. That's why God from the very beginning put a plan into practice where God would come in the flesh. They had to share this great news because you know what was given to them? It was a gift. It wasn't based on their worth. It wasn't based on anything they had done or not done. It was given to them as a gift. These angels just show up. And it belongs to everyone else, this good news. Selfish people will just have cold, indifferent hearts. What's mine is mine. But this great news. And generosity says this, what's mine is not just mine, but it's a gift that has been given to me to give thanks to God and to be a blessing to others and to make a difference. And you begin to be a blessing when you begin to have this perspective and at this level. So now there's a third and there's a final level that's a higher perspective and a level that some, even Jesus followers, never get to. And it's this perspective. It's that of our loving Heavenly Father and of Joseph and Mary. And it's this perspective. What's mine is not mine. And I'll release it and I'll give it. It's at this level that true freedom really begins to take place. What's mine is not mine. I'm just here to manage it. And it's just on loan to God. And some of you have heard this before. I love what Billy Graham said years ago. He said he's never been to a funeral where there was a hearse hauling a U-Haul trailer behind it. You can't take it with you. What's mine is not mine. It's just on loan to me. And the key is how I grow in managing what God has given to me. And that's the real key. Because for those who are steeped in greed, not just materially, but in every area, enough is never enough. For God so loved the world that he gave. And he gave. And God gave Jesus, the greatest story of generosity that has ever been told. And he sacrificed. And here's the amazing thing. You ready for this? All that your loving Heavenly Father has is yours. When you stepped across the line into a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you know what the Bible says? The Bible says you are adopted as a full-on son and a daughter of the living God. And the Bible says, all that I have is yours. It's already yours. And it all belongs to you with all of the rights and with all of the privileges, eternal life, and all that God has prepared for us. In a relationship with Jesus, we are joint heirs. I love what this says, Romans chapter 8, verse 17. It's not in your note sheet for those of you who might be wondering, but listen to this. Now look, if we are children, then we are heirs. Are we children? The answer is, when you step into a relationship with him, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. That's amazing. And it's not based on anything you can do or not do. We share in the glory that is Jesus. And it's his gift to us. And how about Mary and Joseph? So they come into the temple of the Lord, according to the law of the Lord, and they present their firstborn to God. God, this is a gift from you. And what's mine is not mine. And it's the highest level. God, you've given to me this incredible gift. And what's mine is not mine. It belongs to you. It says his parents brought him to Jerusalem to present him to who? The Lord. And what Mary and Joseph understood is that Jesus was God's child. And Jesus was God's gift to them. The Bible says this, everything that you have and everything that you are is a gift from God. Everything. When we do baby dedications, we are just simply, and it's patterned after this scripture and this pattern, as well as Old Testament scriptures. We're simply saying, dear God, thank you for this great gift of life in our home. And we present our precious little girl or precious little boy to you. And the only people who have a problem with generosity are those who just don't understand. It's not yours. You can't take it. You just can't take it with you. And what part of the Bible, God says, don't you understand when I say it's not yours? It's just on loan to you. And you know what this does? It just frees us up. It just does. So I've used this example before, and I pray that this never happens to any of you. But you go out after church one day and you go to get in your car and it's gone. You go, oh no, where's my car? Somebody stole what? My car. But when you really get this, and look, this is tongue in cheek, and I get it, but you go out and say, God, someone stole your car. Well, it belonged to you, God. These things come and go. The difference, and it's horrible when this happens, but the difference between people that have the right perspective, as long as family is safe, and as long as the kids are okay, the difference between people that have this perspective, it's not mine, it's God, and it's just on loan to me, between those that have that perspective and those who have the perspective, what's mine is mine, and they suffer a loss. And nobody, you want nobody to go through, whether it's the loss of a fire or a hurricane or whatever, no, you want no one to have to experience that. But when it happens, there's a joy and there's a peace because of the right perspective on generosity. Well, it's yours, God. And it all belongs to you. Well, God will only give to you what he knows will flow through you with the right perspective of generosity. I mean, look what Jesus said. Jesus said this, look, if you try to hang on to your life, you'll lose it. But if you're giving up your life for my sake, you will save it. So Christmas generosity, let's bring it home. Christmas generosity, what is it? Here it is. It's coming to worship. It's just coming to worship and to give thanks to God and to enjoy his presence and to be with his people. Hooray for you for being here in the busyness of it all. And I am so glad once again that you're here. So the Magi, where is he that has been born King of the Jews? We've seen his star in the east and we have come to worship. And there's nothing in the text that would suggest that there was an angel sent once they get there. And the Magi, they bow down and they worship and give Jesus their gifts, which, by the way, funded the 2-year trip to Egypt. It's all part of God's plan. But there's nowhere in the text that an angel showed up and said, you Magi, you're so commercialized. Get out of here. It was just gifts of worship. We have come to worship. Next, Christmas generosity is allowing joy to sweep over your soul in spite of the outside circumstances. And let me say it again, for some during this time of the year, there are so many stressors, even a sadness that can seem to sink in because of a loss, because of something that you've suffered in 2019. But the joy of the Lord is eternal. It never leaves. It never changes. It's choosing joy, regardless of the outside circumstances. And it's moving closer into the presence of a living God. And then it's just telling others. It's not just for you, this great news and these gifts. And how easy it is for us to think, God, I work hard. Well, who gave you the ability to do your work? You go, look, I really had to think and I had to try to figure things out. Well, who gave you your brain? It's God. Every good and perfect gift, the Bible says, comes from the Father above. It's telling others. It's spreading the message. What a loving, generous, heavenly Father. Anybody thankful for a generous God? We love you, Lord, and give you praise, and glory, and honor. Now pray with me. Father, in Jesus' name, the name above every name, the name that brings joy and peace. What an announcement. What a celebration. When you splayed across the sky a heavenly light to these shepherds, and when you proclaimed, I bring news of great joy. That's for all people. And a miracle star as the Magi came and worshiped Jesus. You will not go without celebration. You said that if we don't worship, the rocks will have to cry out. I don't want a rock taking my place, Jesus. We want to worship and give you praise. I want to pray for you. You would say, I'm not sure quite at what level of generosity I find myself in, if truth be known. Maybe you've lived far too long and what's mine is mine. Don't touch it. Don't come near it. And maybe you were even thinking of, where's this going? Others of you might be saying, well, I can go along with what's mine is yours, but that highest level, what's mine is not mine. It all belongs to God. And God's just been touching you. And maybe some of the source of pain and heartache on the inside is just being able to release. To say, God, it all belongs to you. Can I pray for you? I want to have, as your spiritual coach and mentor and as your pastor, I want to pray for you and say, man, I could use some of this joy and presence and the stressors of it all and the busyness of the season. Hooray for you for being here. And you would say, I needed this. Eyes are closed. Can I pray for you, though? Would you lift your hand front to back and left to right? There are hands all across the room. Father, you see the hands of every man and every woman front to back and left to right who would say, Jesus, thank you for your joy. Thank you for your peace. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you that you burst forth on the scene with generosity far beyond my understanding and your love just for us unconditionally. Touch every heart, every life, and start with me, Jesus, and every person in this room. In your name we pray. And everyone said, let's give the Lord another clap offering, church. We love you, Lord, and give you praise.